Throughout the New Year celebrations, the authorities were anticipating a terrorist attack. The world's last superpower, America, put its citizens across the globe on alert. The fear came from this man, Osama bin Laden. He's been accused of masterminding nearly every major terrorist attack against Americans in the last decade, of destabilizing the Arab world and the Russian Caucasus. He has called on Muslims worldwide, including Britain, to fight and die in holy wars in foreign lands. But it seems all this is the inevitable consequence of a conspiracy hatched 20 years ago by the American Secret Service and the White House. Twenty years ago, in January 1980, the then President of the United States, Jimmy Carter, condemned the Russian invasion and communist takeover of Afghanistan.
This is a callous violation of international law and the United Nations Charter. It is a deliberate effort of a powerful atheistic government to subjugate an independent Islamic people.
The Soviet superpower ignored world opinion, but they were confronted with an Islamic resistance as a quarter of a million fighters picked up arms to defend the Muslims of Afghanistan.
It unified Muslims from across the world in opposing the atheistic regime of communism that the Russians tried to impose on Afghanistan, which was a Muslim state.
This struggle against infidel Russian invaders was called a jihad, a holy war. Fighting this oppression was considered a religious duty, as the Koran and the Kalashnikov shared the battlefield. The mujahideen, or holy warriors, were depicted at the time as freedom fighters. President Ronald Reagan blessed this holy war with billions of dollars and state-of-the-art weaponry. Then, to world astonishment, the mujahideen defeated the Soviet army as communism was conquered in the mountains of Afghanistan.
The notion of Soviet invulnerability, of Soviet invincibility, of Soviet historical inevitability was shattered.
But 20 years later, the Mujahideen of Afghanistan emerged as the new global enemy. In the 10 years since the end of the anti-Soviet war, jihad has been exported to 22 countries around the world, and it is no longer perceived to be holy.
At the end of the communist era, when communism stopped being the evil, we've quite blatantly seen that in the eyes of the West, especially in the eyes of the American government, Islam has taken the bogeyman's place of communism. When they were using us to fight the Russians, we were freedom fighters. When that war is won and the oppression moves to other lands where they don't want us to fight, we become fundamentalist terrorists.
America claims that Afghanistan has become the global center for terrorism. It is also where the world's most wanted man, Osama bin Laden, is believed to be hiding.
Today, I ordered our armed forces to strike at terrorist-related facilities in Afghanistan. Terrorism is one of the greatest dangers we face in this new global era. We saw its twisted mentality at work last week in the embassy bombings in Nairobi and Dar es Salaam, which took the lives of innocent Americans and Africans and injured thousands more. Today, we have struck back.
The alleged terrorist training camps that were bombed in Afghanistan in 1998 were the facilities that the Americans and their ally at the time, Pakistan, helped set up to train and arm the mujahideen, including Osama bin Laden, to fight the holy war against communism. The story of the Afghan jihad has become distinctly unholy for all concerned, and the consequences are still with us today.
The activities of today, especially in the Arab world, destabilization of their societies, the attacks on their governments by young, for the most part, guerrillas, are the result of the Afghan war, in that the 250,000 or more people who were trained by the CIA and the Pakistani military to fight the Russians went home and directly began, many of them, to foment these guerrilla operations in their own countries and elsewhere.
Throughout the 90s, Muslim militancy hit the headlines. Russia justifies its war against the Islamic Republic of Chechnya, where civilians are dying every week, as a war against Muslim rebels. And in 1995, the then Secretary General of NATO spoke of Islam as the new communism.
I'm afraid that unless there's a great awakening in the West soon, we're going to see Islam being universally demonized as communism was before.
Despite this apparent demonization, for the vast majority of Muslims, Islam is a religion of peace, and it continues to convert. As we celebrate the millennium, which marks 2,000 years since the birth of Jesus Christ, Islam is the second largest and the fastest growing religion in the world. Muslims believe that 600 years after the death of Jesus Christ, God, Allah, sent another prophet, the last prophet. He was called Muhammad, born in a town called Mecca, and chosen by God to transcribe the divine message documented in Islam's holy book, the Quran. This states that the Prophet Muhammad had been sent as a messenger to lead people back onto the straight path to God. A 100 years after the death of this new prophet, the Islamic Empire was already greater than Christian Rome and reached Europe by the 8th century. The Pope reacted to this Muslim expansion by launching Christendom's version of holy wars called the Crusades. Although Islam was not conquered, a lasting legacy of distrust was established. Where the Crusades had failed, European colonialism succeeded, and the Islamic Empire was finally dismantled by the 20th century. As new nation-states were established after colonial rule, Muslim leaders ranged from military-backed dictatorships to absolute monarchies. And as Muslims migrated or became displaced, Islam began to be interpreted in many different ways in many different countries. Diversity, rather than unity, characterizes the Muslim world today. But one unity that has persisted is support for the freedom struggles of Muslim people, be it in Kosovo or Chechnya, despite being largely ignored by the West.
Unfortunately today, Muslim blood has become cheaper than fox blood. You could get more people out demonstrating against fox hunting than you can when people, Muslim people, are being hunted in Chechnya. And that is the reality today, that Muslim people are being butchered and killed all over the world.
It is the five pillars of Islam that unite the Muslim people. Like Jews and Christians, they believe that there is only one God, but that the Prophet Muhammad was his last messenger.
Allahu Akbar.
Muslims believe that they should pray five times a day, give a percentage of their income to charity, fast 30 days of the year from sunrise to sunset, and that they should go on pilgrimage to Mecca in Arabia, where the Prophet was born, at least once in their lifetime. Then there's jihad, often referred to as the sixth pillar, and often misunderstood. The Muslims fighting Indian rule in Kashmir have been described as terrorists, but some would argue, even in the House of Lords, that this is a legitimate struggle.
I'm a Kashmiri. I support Kashmiri's right of self-determination. I will always support Kashmiri's right of self-determination. And I said this on camera too, that as a Kashmiri, I want to support the Kashmiri people who are fighting oppression. There are 700,000 soldiers in Kashmir, the most heavily militarized area on earth. If the United Nations is not going to take any action, if the West is not going to take any action, then Kashmiri people have to fight back.
Jihad means struggle against injustice and can take a variety of forms. The Prophet Muhammad declared that the supreme jihad was against one's own vices. However, this spiritual interpretation has been eclipsed by one of the many other forms of jihad, armed struggle. But even this is meant to be a holy war, and the Prophet, through example, set out guidelines. Jihad was not a war of aggression, and attacks on property, places of worship, and civilians were condemned. But that was 1400 years ago. Today, jihad has become an effective weapon for terrorists to justify their actions and leaders to mobilize the Muslim population. The story of this 20th century jihad begins in 1979 in Iran, where the struggle for a post-colonial Islamic identity overthrew the Shah of Iran and the most powerful regime in the Middle East.
We particularly welcome you and the Empress as good friends and old friends.
Although the West saw the Shah of Iran as an enlightened, westernized monarch, to his own people he had become an increasingly autocratic ruler. Grassroots discontent, dissent that was often voiced in the mosque, spilled over into the streets, and the world witnessed the first great Islamic revolution of our time. Jihad was the rallying call that the Ayatollah Khomeini used to mobilize the Muslims of Iran.
That revolution represented for some the ability of people, despite the overwhelming power of a regime seen as secular, as excessively dependent on the West, and as an oppressive regime and an autocratic regime, the ability of people to overthrow that regime, the ability of an unarmed people in general, unarmed people to overthrow a regime that was armed to the teeth and that used its arms.
The Ayatollah represented a return to religion in a country that was tired of looking to the West for support and an identity. Not only had the Shah of Iran been rejected, but the Western secular idea of separating religion and politics had also been overthrown. For the West, Iran became the embodiment of the new Islamic threat. And as the Ayatollah urged other Muslims to rise up and fight against corrupt governments in the Gulf and to rid the Arab world of Western influence, Western fear of other Islamic revolutions or jihads grew. Some Muslims in Iran responded to the Ayatollah's call by seizing the US embassy in Tehran.
With the fall of the Shah, the expulsion of the Americans from Iran, the seizure of the American embassy in Tehran in 1979, the taking of over 50 American diplomatic hostages there, who were held for almost 2 years, these were seen as catastrophic events in the West and were regarded as a wake-up call. Watch out, the Muslims are coming.
Just across the border from Iran, an Islamic revival was also taking place in Afghanistan. It threatened to topple the communist regime that had come to power the previous year. To quell the growing Muslim resistance, the Soviet Union invaded on Christmas Eve 1979. The Muslims of Afghanistan fought back. For them, this was a defensive armed struggle against infidel invaders, and a jihad or holy war was declared.
When the Soviets invaded Afghanistan, suddenly there was a chance to get Islam on our side, on the side of the West. And the Americans very cleverly, I think, seized the opportunity by supporting them.
The West, who opposed communism on political grounds, and the Muslims, who opposed communism on religious grounds, could now be united in fighting the supreme enemy, the Soviet Union. And President Carter's national security advisor seized the opportunity.
Literally, the day after the Soviet action in Kabul, I wrote a memo to the president in which the key sentence was, "We now have the opportunity to give the Soviet Union its Vietnam."
Those Afghan guerrillas were going to fight whether they had only the Enfield rifles that the British had left for them from World War I, or whether they had the better munitions that we could provide them. And so I found that I could, in conscience, support this and went to the president and said, "Let's start this supply of arms to the Afghan insurgents." And we started it very soon after the Soviet invasion took place at the end of 1979.
The first aim was to give the Russians as bloody a nose as possible, especially after the massive aid they'd given to the North Vietnamese and all those American casualties in Vietnam. So this was, if you will, a payback.
In this Cold War environment, a covert policy was developed. Billions of dollars were provided by America and its Middle Eastern allies, particularly Saudi Arabia, whilst Pakistan's secret intelligence services coordinated the fighting. As this was a clandestine operation at the time, the Afghan mujahideen were initially supplied with only Soviet-made weapons.
We supplied weapons which could logically only have been, or ostensibly have been, found on the battlefield, the ancient 303 Enfields and various Soviet made weapons such as the rocket launchers, the RPG-7s, the Kalashnikovs, the Soviet made heavy machine guns.
Allahu Akbar!
On the 10th of January, the first weapons that we sent got in there. So that was very quick, 13 days, in come the arms.
This was the first time in the history of Islam that you had a jihad which was sanctioned by forces outside the Islamic world. In the modern times, it is this dominant Western culture decided that what was taking place in Afghanistan was a jihad. It was legitimate to do it. It was nothing illegal to go and fight in. It was also happening in front of television cameras. So it was sending powerful messages to people. It was redefining the very concept of jihad, because now jihad become fighting in the battlefield.
Thousands of mujahideen from a range of different backgrounds flocked to the city of Peshawar in Pakistan in order to cross the border to join the anti-Soviet jihad in Afghanistan.
Even to this day, it unites Muslim peoples like nothing has united them in the last 100 years. Communism is an atheistic regime, so of course, as Muslims, we must oppose it. That being the case, yes, it rejuvenated and it actually made Muslims aware of what they were and who they are, and that the fact that they could oppose evil from non-Muslim regimes, whether it was from the East or from the West.
One of the first mujahideen fighters to arrive in Afghanistan was the 22-year-old son of a Saudi Arabian billionaire. He was called Usama bin Laden. He became one of the wealthiest private financiers of the Afghan jihad. His family built their wealth through land development, and he used these skills to construct roads and tunnels and hospitals for the wounded. He also acquired, for some, an almost mythic status.
He was a Muslim helping other Muslims. He was a multi-millionaire from one of the richest families in Saudi Arabia. He didn't have to go, but he went and sacrificed himself and his wealth for the benefit of others in Afghanistan.
Dana Rohrabacher, one of Ronald Reagan's speechwriters during his presidency, went out to Afghanistan to meet the mujahideen at this time.
Bin Laden personally showed some courage during the Afghan war. He was, after all, he was there. There were some mortars and airplane attacks and helicopter gunships and landmines, all of which could have easily taken his life. And he had the courage to go. And now, I don't know whether the stories of bin Laden in battle are true or not. They may not be true, that he actually ran into Soviet camps and killed people with his own hands. Now, I don't know if that's true or not, but he was at least there.
The appeal of Osama bin Laden lies in his image, or how the Muslim world perceives him. Very charismatic, the Che Guevara of the Muslim world. He is totally a product of the Afghani war. The CIA has admitted it, and he's accepted it, that he was trained and encouraged by the CIA during, you know, the early 80s. He is made for the era of television. You need heroes who are bigger than life. And he did not come bigger than Osama bin Laden.
Apart from the heroes they created, the mujahideen had another secret weapon, their faith. For the holy warrior, death in battle is an honor, life is a sacrifice, and the reward is paradise.
Faith. Faith in victory, faith in personal redemption, faith in the positive consequences of individual sacrifice was a very major motivating factor in making the Afghans fight in a way that the Soviet recruits could not fight.
But faith was fighting a Soviet superpower, and inevitably the roll call of martyrs grew. Then, in 1986, American support arrived in the shape of Milt Bearden, the first CIA man to conduct missions inside Afghanistan.
By the time I arrived on the scene, we're talking about 1 million dead, maybe 1.5 million had been wounded, and Iran and Pakistan were just overloaded, jammed with refugees driven out of Afghanistan. So I was confronted with this, the sights and sounds of a situation like that, and it allowed one not to have any reservations about what we were doing.
And what they were doing amounted to a major escalation of U.S. involvement. Milt Bearden was brought in to teach the Mujahideen fighters how to use the Stinger missile.
Up until 1986, all of the weaponry that we had provided to the Afghan Mujahideen was Warsaw Pact. And the Stinger was apple pie. It was red, white, and blue, American. The Stinger is fire and forget. They know that there is a movement of helicopters coming from Kabul, and they're waiting for them. They come in, they turn on their Stingers, and the first gunner fires. It just flies across the sky with that big white plume behind it, and it hits the first helicopter, brings it immediately to the ground right beside the runway of this airfield, and then they get two and three. Just in quick succession, they come all down, and it turned the war around.
The relentless war in Afghanistan lasted 10 long years, with the loss of 15,000 Russian lives and over 1 million Afghani lives. The once mighty Soviet army were humbled, defeated, and sent home in 1989. This had proved to be, as Brzezinski had hoped it would, Russia's Vietnam.
I felt good when the Soviets retreated across that river. I felt really good. I felt that the effort was not in vain, and that this was also the beginning of something much greater, namely that the retreat across the river from Afghanistan was not just a retreat from Afghanistan. It was the beginning of something much bigger, that we saw subsequently.
In fact, it seems the defeat at the hands of the Afghan Mujahideen was the beginning of the end of the great Soviet Empire.
as the Soviets withdrew their army from Afghanistan, very sharp notice of that was taken by the people of Hungary, Poland, and East Germany. And I think they were emboldened to do what they did throughout the summer of 1989, when the Hungarians were the first to see clearly that the Soviets could not move against them again, as they did in 1956, and they cut their wire with the Austrian border, on the Austrian border, and opened up the Iron Curtain the first time. I think the Poles found that they weren't going to have anybody move in with Russian tanks after that exhausting battle. And they had an election in June of 1989 that kicked out communism once and for all and brought in that little electrician from Gdańsk, and Solidarity wins. And I think the East German people who were out in the streets all through the summer, first in tentative numbers of a few thousand and then up to 500,000 in Leipzig, or 1,000,000, they also felt that they could do this because the Soviets simply weren't coming this time.
America was mesmerized by the collapse of communism and what they saw as the triumph of democracy. But Afghanistan, the land where the Soviet superpower had first been defeated, lay in ruins. Up to two-thirds of its population had become refugees.
The greatest mistake that was made by the United States during that period of the Afghan war and thereafter was that once we had won the war, or once our, or I should say the Afghans won the war with our help, we walked away. We walked away and we left it to Pakistan and we left it to Saudi Arabia to try to rebuild the area and to reestablish civil order in Afghanistan and tried to bring the region out of this conflict. That was a terrible mistake.
The Americans walked away from Afghanistan, leaving the mujahideen feeling betrayed. At the end of the Afghan war, many were deported back to their own countries. Some were arrested on arrival, some executed. They now posed a threat.
They were taught skills from how to garrote a man with a wire from behind, how to capture a village with just two or three people, how to blow up a railway line, how to sabotage an oil refinery. Nobody seems to have foreseen the consequences of training and arming all these young men, who, many of whom had no other professional skill or interest in life, to be very fierce fighters, and, if you like, terrorists.
We spent billions of pounds fighting the Cold War. And it was Osama bin Laden and his people in Afghanistan who fought our war, who gave million people, who gave life to fight communism in Afghanistan. That's what we need to remember, that those million people sacrificed their lives for the West to destroy Soviet Union. And it suited us to have Osama bin Laden building roads and building hospitals, who became a hero. He became a symbol of jihad and mujahideen.
The holy warriors were now on the run as international fugitives. As they shifted their attention from communism to the struggles raging in the Muslim world, they found a new cause. But as they spoke the language of jihad against what they saw as oppressive regimes, their uncompromising demands for change were not welcome.
They were fighting in Afghanistan for, had the support, for instance, of Washington, London, and Paris. The same thing, once they started to fight it in their own Muslim countries, were not acceptable. So suddenly they turned, they found themselves from being heroes, they were being villains. From being mujahid, they were now terrorists. A lot of them have been jailed and some of them killed in the Muslim countries. And then in a way they became not soldiers of fortune, but roaming soldiers of Allah. We ended up finding them in Bosnia, in Kosovo, in Chechnya, and Kashmir. In some of them managed to get into Palestine, and also in the Yemen and other trouble spots in the Muslim world.
The arms supplied during the Afghan jihad were not recovered, and the facilities set up during the war, religious schools, training camps, the nursery slopes for the mujahideen, had matured into what were soon being described as schools of terrorism. Men from over 40 countries were to come to Afghanistan as it became known as the global center for the mujahideen to train and prepare for jihads elsewhere.
It created a role model for a lot of young people who, because they're living in this political environment which are very oppressive in the Muslim world, who've tried everything, democracy, who've tried everything, but it does not work. So they thought the only way that real change can come anywhere is perhaps by taking up arms and confronting the enemy on the battlefield.
On the plains of Afghanistan, when we armed these mujahideen fighters, one lesson we learned then was that arming insurgencies can be very effective in bringing about world peace, but at the same time, it doesn't stop right there.
As the mujahideen emerged from the holy war in Afghanistan, they saw an unholy war taking place in the Gulf. This was to prove the turning point for Usama bin Laden, who'd come out of the Afghan jihad with a reputation for some as a leader. The West were accused of having supported Saddam Hussein when Iraq had gone to war with the Ayatollah's Iran 10 years earlier. But it was the West that the Saudis turned to for help when Saddam invaded Kuwait. To the mujahideen, who saw themselves as the moral and military guardians of the Muslim world, this was the ultimate betrayal.
Britain, Western Europe and America had armed, financed and created the bogeyman himself, Saddam Hussein. Saudi Arabia supplied him with $20 billion of aid and Kuwait with over $40 billion of aid during the war against Iran that killed 1 million of his own people and over 1 million Iranians. And then suddenly we're supposed to believe he's the bogeyman and this new Hitler in the Middle East who's going to take over the oil wells.
To the mujahideen, it was the West who were taking over the Holy Land. The sacred sites of Islam lie in Saudi Arabia and access is forbidden to non-Muslims. 10 years after the liberation of Kuwait, thousands of foreign troops are still there, and this has become an explosive issue.
Why are they still there? They're there to defend the oil fields to make sure that until they're bled dry, nobody else threatens them.
Osama bin Laden accused the Saudi government of colluding with the West at the expense of the Islamic world. They responded by stripping him of his native citizenship in 1994. 4 years later, now an international fugitive, he announced the creation of the Islamic Front for Jihad. This was an international coalition of radical groups from various countries. The aim was to establish an Islamic state. The obstacle standing in the way was the West and what they saw as corrupt Muslim governments. The solution was jihad. In the 90s, this was to become an offensive rather than a defensive struggle, as bin Laden issued a fatwa against the United States.
They have made the United States their adversary precisely because of what we stand for and what we stand against. A few months ago, and again this week, bin Laden publicly vowed to wage a terrorist war against America, saying, and I quote, "We do not differentiate between those dressed in military uniforms and civilians. They're all targets. Their mission is murder, and their history is bloody."
To Muslims who condemn Osama bin Laden's interpretation of jihad, their religion is being used to excuse the inexcusable. To the West, like the Ayatollah Khomeini before him, he has come to embody the fear of Islam.
In Islam, terrorism is not allowed. In Islam, jihad is allowed to fight oppression. Jihad is allowed to fight a particular cause. Jihad is allowed to fight your own internal yourself against any criminal activity that you may be involved with, but to target and terrorize any community in the name of Islam is totally wrong, and it has to be differentiated separated from the word jihad. A terrorist is a terrorist, and it cannot be mixed with jihad.
But the distinction between jihad and terrorism became blurred in the 1990s, as some Muslims became increasingly radical in the name of religion. Although jihad movements have existed for centuries, the Afghan war added a new dimension. The most significant uprisings and attacks throughout the last decade have been linked, either directly or indirectly, to the Afghan war veterans. It is claimed that using the skills acquired during that war, Osama bin Laden launched a jihad movement that covered the globe. Some of the Afghan war veterans went on to defend what they saw as oppressed Muslims in other parts of the world. Kashmir, Sudan, Somalia, Chechnya, Bosnia, as jihad went global. Some returned to their own countries to spearhead violent struggles against what they saw as Western-backed corrupt regimes in places like Egypt and Algeria. And some went to war with the West itself, particularly America, the world's only remaining superpower. The World Trade Center in New York was bombed in 1993. America had been hit by an international terrorist attack on its own soil for the first time.
In recent years, they killed American, Belgian, and Pakistani peacekeepers in Somalia. They plotted to assassinate the president of Egypt and the Pope. They planned to bomb six United States 747s over the Pacific. They bombed the Egyptian embassy in Pakistan. They gunned down German tourists in Egypt. The most recent terrorist events are fresh in our memory.
In 1998, on the 8th anniversary of the entry of US troops in the Gulf, American embassies in Nairobi, Kenya, and Dar es Salaam, Tanzania, were bombed, killing 224 people and injuring 5,000. Osama bin Laden denied responsibility, but admitted he admired those that had carried out the attacks.
We now seem to be moving into a phase in which the terrorists are ideological. They're out there to do something to damage the United States. We are out there as a very obvious, visible target for people who want to run regimes with no human rights, with no liberty, with no democracy. It's a struggle that's going to go on, and we're going to win.
In order to win, America focused on Osama bin Laden and targeted states accused of protecting him by launching 75 cruise missiles at Afghanistan and Sudan. The missile attack on Afghanistan killed 24 people, but missed bin Laden. The bombing of the Al-Shifa plant in Sudan was contentious. American officials claimed it produced chemical weapons and was linked to Osama bin Laden. The Sudanese, led by their president, took to the streets protesting it produced 90% of Sudan's much-needed medical supplies. The American assault on two of the poorest Muslim countries in the world was condemned by many.
You will see the consequences over years, which then creates this anxiety and, of course, hatred within the popular movements within these Muslim countries, and really brings instability in other countries to say, well, look at the United States in the way it behaves. You know, it really behaves in a way like a world gangster is behaving.
A few more failed attacks like the attack on Khartoum, you know, in a number of other areas where maybe more lives are lost illegitimately, can in fact feed anti-Westernism and anti-Americanism and legitimate what many terrorists will say about a West that is anti-Islamic.
USA! USA! USA!
Jihad
is on its way!
Protests against the American bombing were also seen on the streets of London as the influence of a global Islamic struggle hit home. Britain has traditionally given asylum to political dissidents. Some are using these liberal freedoms to speak out against foreign regimes that they see as oppressive. And this now includes America.
For any serious political opposition or somebody who wants to continue influencing politics in the Muslim world and wants, for one reason or another, cannot live in their country, to come to London. You know, there are more than 56 Muslim nationalities living in London. Also, London is the center of all the major Arab papers. Today, the largest selling book within the British Muslim community, particularly amongst young people, is the sayings and pronouncements of Osama bin Laden.
And Osama bin Laden's message is being heard by many, like Yusuf, born a Jew and now a Muslim activist.
We believe, and we have ample evidence across the world today, that the non-Muslim world, or the powers that be within the non-Muslim world, certainly don't respect Islam or people. I mean, why is it the majority of the people in the world today are suffering on Muslims at the hands not just of Christians, i.e. in Serbia or Russia, in Chechnya, but at the hands of Jews in the Middle East, Lebanon, Palestine, etc., but also as Buddhists and Hindus, Kashmir, Burma. But across the Muslim world, Muslims are suffering at the hands of non-Muslims.
What confuses this subjective interpretation still further is that the West has offered selective support to some of these struggles. In Bosnia, the Serbian ethnic cleansing of Muslims was compared to the Nazi Holocaust inflicted on the Jews in World War II. The West sent in a UN peacekeeping force. But as an arms embargo is placed on the Bosnian government, 4,000 mujahideen from across the world picked up arms instead.
When I was in Sarajevo during the conflict in 94, a woman came up to us and she said, "You bring us food and you bring us clothing and you keep us warm in the winter and you keep us well fed and you keep us healthy with medicine. Why? So the Serbs can come down from the mountains like wolves and rape us because we don't have weapons to defend ourselves? Better you bring us weapons so that we can at least die fighting than you keep us warm so they can rape us."
When it came to Kosovo, the West did offer military support. Indeed, NATO used the same sort of language as the mujahideen to justify what some have called the first humanitarian war of the 20th century.
Western support probably saved a good deal of what we might call European Muslims in this context. And that could be one of the shiny moments that one could then take advantage of to try to turn to some advantage in improving relations between the West and the Muslim world.
The ethnic cleansing of Islamic people in Bosnia and Kosovo has led some British-born Muslims who feel increasingly threatened to undergo military-type training. But the British government is drafting new anti-terrorism legislation to combat the potential domestic threat of those who become involved in jihads or armed conflict overseas.
The perceived threat is that there are people coming back from different parts of the world who are trained, that will train others. It's legit to train a Muslim when he's in the territorial army, but if he goes abroad and gets trained and comes back and trains people, then it's illegitimate. Why? He's not breaking the law.
He may not be breaking the law, but most people fail to understand why, in a peaceful democracy, Muslims would feel it was necessary to train.
Ask Stephen Lawrence's family if it's a peaceful democracy and what justice they get. Ask the people in the Bangladeshi youths in the East End of London and the Isle of Dogs what democracy did they get. Who defended them? They defended themselves. Joyce Gardner. So many others. How many Muslims and other non-white people have been killed in police custody? Who defended them? Eventually, when nobody will defend you, it's left for yourself to defend yourself and yours. And if that means that we have to defend our own communities because the state will not defend us, then we will defend our own communities.
For some Muslims, the war in Chechnya is the latest example of Western inconsistency, and this has once again become an Islamic issue.
These are oppressions that exist against humanity rather than a particular group of a particular religion. I think what annoys Muslims is that when the media is using terminology like Muslim terrorists, Muslim warlords, Islamic warlords, and that's why then it becomes their issue. And that's why to some, you know, it suggests, well, these are Muslims again, you know, they're the ones that have bombed Moscow, so therefore they should face the consequences.
To the Russians, the ongoing story of Muslim rebels began in Afghanistan and ends in Chechnya, all masterminded by Osama bin Laden. They accuse him of financially supporting and inciting a Muslim revival in Russia, and of the bombings in Moscow that killed 300 people. This provided them with the justification to invade Chechnya and suppress the rebels.
You have to remember that 4 years ago, Chechens won war against Russians. Russians were humiliated and defeated in Chechnya. Then Chechnya became an independent country. Now, for 4 years, KGB has masterminded in getting this message across to the Western world that all Chechens are terrorists.
20 years after the Afghan war, Russian and American intelligence services are sharing information on the threat of Islamic rebels. The Muslims of Chechnya are now fighting for independence and an Islamic state, led, of course, by an Afghan war veteran.
I was in a mosque yesterday in the night, and the whole day, Imam was talking about Chechnya, about what is going on there. And one thing again, Chechnya is like an Afghanistan for the 90s, in the sense that Chechnya has got everybody supporting it. The only missing ingredient in Chechnya is to the sanctification by the West of the jihad that is going there. Now, remember, you're talking about British Muslims who are part of the Western world. So now they are questioning why this double standard is taking place and we are here. And what is our responsibility towards this?
For some Muslims, there is little difference between the jihad in Afghanistan in 1979 and the Russian bombardment of Chechnya today. 20 years ago this month, the mujahideen in Afghanistan were freedom fighters. Today, they are seen as terrorists. For the mujahideen, the inconsistencies of the West over the last 20 years demonstrate that the non-Muslim world may be politically sophisticated, but is morally bankrupt.
Muslims, whether they're white, black, Asian, Arab, whether they're religious or not religious, whether they're street guys in Birmingham or London, when oppression starts, they will fight. And they will fight because they have no choice in the matter.
But that's something completely different.